Okay, there are a handful of assignments I'm asking for today. Assuming we have minute of silence, you should be looking under bell work to see which ones are going to be due. That way you can be rounding them up during the minute of silence. You've not given me your late and complete work, and in Google Classroom, a handful of you guys turned these assignments in already, but 34, 36, 37, and 38. 38 was the circuit on using the calculator last class. 37 was your test review. 36 was basic related rates worksheet where we got extra practice, and 34 was the related rate circuit. So I'm not picking up any of those assignments in a while, but with our test today, you need to get those in. Okay, additionally, we will be starting with the calculator part of today's test. So it is split into calculator and non-calculator. So if you clear off your desk, I can get you the calculator part and let you get started. And then I'll give you more directions. Thank you.
first part that you are getting or currently have is the calculator part. It is four of the multiple choice questions and the FRQ on the back. Okay, let's skip anybody, just go ahead and step out. Okay, so of course this is the part of the test you're welcome to use a calculator on. That doesn't mean that every one of these questions should need a calculator, but you're welcome to use it if you think it will work the question for you, or if you think it will help, or if you think you can check your answers that way. But thank you. Like I said last time, when we do these, now that we're moving into pretty much the standard format, most of your tests will be this format. 9 multiple choice, 1 FRQ, not everyone, but most of them. So the FRQ totals up for half of the points, and all the multiple choice questions total up for the other half. So, I don't know, in my experience, I think it's good. Sometimes the stuff in the FRQ doesn't jump out at you. So I tend to advise students to start with the FRQ, then go and do the other questions, and then come back to the FRQ. If nothing else, that way if you get stuck, I don't know, mentally you're still kind of thinking about it in the back of your mind, but you can do that how you want. So 9 points for the multiple choice total, 9 points for the FRQ, and then that will be curved and scaled to 40 points in the gradebook. So it's worth the same amount as your last test. So take as much time as you need to with this part, but realize that there is a few more questions for you to do. So when you are finished with that part, you can either bring your first part up here or just raise your hand, and then I will bring you the no calculator part. So I will not take up your calculator portion when you get the no calculator part, but once you move on from the calculator portion of the test, you have to put your calculator up and it doesn't come back out. So I guess you could even just do the parts of the calculator thing that you think you need a calculator for, and then you can move on. So I think that addresses all of that, but let me know if you guys have other questions about the directions, please.
I
I
Okay, you can keep this at your desk. You just need to put your calculator up. number, you can move on to the second part as soon as you know you're done with the calculator. I'm not taking this first part away from you, but once you put your calculator up, you can't get it back out, so. can still keep working on the first part. It's just that once you get the note calculator, your calculator has to say about for this.
Thank you.
Staple, put in the box, candy if you want it, and then pick up the handouts on the front. And you can also pick up your homework if you want it back right now. I need to see which form of the test you have. Staple, basket, candy if you want it. Got the handouts up front and your graded homework. Thank you. Staple basket handy if you want to grab your handouts on the front desk and your graded papers. Staple, please. Staple them first. Candy if you want it, and you need to get the handouts up front. please. Candy, if you want it, and then you need the handouts up front, and grab your homework up front, too. Thank you.
staple, tenon, candy if you want it. You have to hand out up front and grab the marks if you want. Staple, basket, candy if you want it, and grab the handout up front, and your homeworks if you want.
Well, you put homework, you mean the one over in the beginning of class? Or?
Yeah, I put your graded homework in that white box over there. You don't have to get it back today, but if no one else is over there, you might as well. Handouts up front, please. Thank you. Make sure you get the handouts up front. Thank you.
couple of retakes.
Okay. Wait, I'll do retakes.
Can I still get points in this? I just found it in my folder.
Yes, but you need to get your binder together so that this doesn't happen again.
staple, please. Heavy basket. Candy if you want it, and then make sure you get the handout up front and your homework if you want it.
Still working, that's fine, but if you are finished, you need to make sure you grab the handout at the front desk over there. And obviously we're not got about 10 minutes here, so we're not going to get very far on this, but I do want to go ahead and start looking at it. So if you need these last few minutes for your test, I guess that impacts your grade more, so I get it, but you'll need to watch the last few minutes of today's class recording so that you can catch up what you had missed.
Staple and touch basket, please. Okay, so good news, bad news is,
the good news is the next, or pretty much all the rest of the derivative stuff we have to do the rest of the semester has little to no bearing on your ability to do implicit differentiation or related rates. So for some of you, that's good news. The bad news is, because you don't get to practice it very much, that means when we get into AP review mode next semester, you'll have to kind of, you know, I mean, it'll come to you much easier the second time, but you'll have to start off with basic related rates and kind of work your way up a little bit, and same with implicit. So pretty much all the rest of the derivative stuff that we do this semester is considered function analysis. So basically you're given the graph of something, or you're given the equation of something, and we want to know, what does this look like on a graph? When's it going up? When is it concave up, concave down? When's it going down? When's it increasing, decreasing? All of that kind of stuff. So the first thing we're gonna look at, I don't remember if I numbered this or not, or never mind, I know I did, but when it copied, it didn't print off real great. It cut it off a little bit. So both of these pages make up number 40, so if you can't read that very well on the top right, fill it in a little bit. But this one starts off, I think it starts off pretty intuitive, as long as you have ingrained in your head that derivative is synonymous with slope. So this first little example they have for us here is obviously a quadratic. So what you, the connections you need to make from what you already know from algebra 2 and beyond to calculus is that if from here to here, if the slope is positive, it's going up, so the slope is positive, that means that the derivative is positive. Slope and derivative mean the same thing. When the derivative is, or when the slope is negative, that is when the first derivative is negative. And when the slope is zero, like right at this instant, when the slope is zero, the derivative is zero. So some of the stuff that we'll be using the first derivative test for, or use, I'm sorry, not the first derivative test. The first derivative test has a very specific purpose. But we use the first derivative to figure out when a function is at rest, increasing and decreasing. Because if we can find derivatives, if we can find when the derivative is positive, we know when the graph is increasing. If we can find when the first derivative is negative, we can find when the graph is decreasing. And when the derivative is zero, we know when the function's at rest. Now, the real purpose of the first derivative test is to find extrema, actually, be more specific, relative extrema. So, extrema refers to mins and maxes. So like this is an extremum. It's a relative min. Looking at the small set of data, it's the smallest point. It's where it's switching from decreasing to increasing. Okay, so you need to know something about critical numbers before we dive into actually working one of these. So critical numbers is something that you will have to find. This is when the first derivative is zero or undefined. And the reason that critical numbers are so important, or critical as their name implies, is that when the first derivative is zero, like this picture here, this is where it's probably changing directions. If the graph was decreasing and then it comes to horizontal for an instant, there's a 50-50 chance that it goes the other direction. So critical numbers are usually
relative extrema, but they're not guaranteed because it could be decreasing, go to zero, and then decrease again, and then that wouldn't be a relative extrema. Okay, so like this question, we have a relative minimum at a critical point because the first derivative is changing from negative to positive, and that's the type of justification you're going to have to write for FRQs. When it says justify, how you know there's a minimum there, because it switches from decreasing to increasing, but to say the same thing in calculus, it goes from negative first derivative to positive first derivative. And you could get a maximum is if the graph switches from increasing to decreasing, which means the first derivative is switching from positive to negative. Now, the reason critical numbers are so important is critical numbers are the only place the graph might be changing directions. Okay, so let's look at one example and then we'll call it quits here. Use the first derivative test to find the x values of any relative extrema. So if we're trying to find maxes and mins, just like you did in Algebra 2, it's just that in Algebra 2, you had to go about it a certain way. We can go about it a different way because we can do derivatives. So as the name implies, you should probably take the first derivative. So power rule, bring the power down, lower the power by 1, and chain rule times 2x. So here is the first derivative. Okay, so when does this equal zero? Or when does a fraction equal zero? Okay, and so when does our numerator equal zero?
When x is zero.
Okay. Oops. Okay, so when the numerator is zero, which for us is x equals zero. So that means x equals zero is a critical point, meaning that it's likely to be changing directions there, but not guaranteed. Now, critical numbers also come when the first derivative is undefined. You need to say that in your head every time or you will forget it, and you do get tested on that. Okay, and when is a fraction undefined? Very good. When the denominator equals zero. So you could set the denominator equal to zero, divide both sides by 3, cube both sides, add 4, take the square root of both sides. That would be x is plus or minus 2. So critical numbers, now again, obviously you've got to practice it a few times, but critical numbers come when the first derivative is 0 or undefined. You find the first derivative, set it equal to 0. Those are critical numbers. Set it to where it gives you division by 0 to know where it's undefined. Those are also critical numbers. But to know if these are relative extrema, because these are not guaranteed, we will practice doing this little number line thing. And so you need to do this also. So x equals 0 is a critical number, x equals 2 is a critical number, and x equals negative 2 is a critical number. So those are the only three places the graph might change direction. So I would like to know, is the graph going up or down here? So what I will do is I'll plug in some number between 0 and 2, like something easy, like 1, and I will put that into the first derivative. So if I plug 1 into this, is the numerator positive or negative?
Positive.
If I plug 1 into the denominator, is it positive or negative?
Negative.
Okay, a positive divided by a negative is
negative.
And what does it mean if the first derivative is negative? Your function is decreasing. If your derivative is negative, your slope is negative. So during this time, I know it's decreasing. So when we pick this back up on Tuesday, we're just running out of time here, we'll test around there, and then we've got a good picture of when the graph's going up and down, and then it's pretty easy to answer the question. But for now, that's a good stopping place. I will do my best to get the test grades in before the weekend. As always, though, make sure you guys please don't talk about the test to your friends. That does affect the curve, which impacts you, so something to keep in mind. But I will do my best to get them in gradebook at least before the weekend. Can't promise.